more than about it.
Hi, I'm Greg Rolfe. I'm a recovered crystal meth addict. And real honor to be up here tonight and have Chris here speaking. Chris was very near and dear to Mark Houston's heart, and Mark spoke very highly of him, and this was planned a long time before Mark passed away. And he wanted it to be in spring because spring is like, you know, the new part of the year, and beautiful things are out, and the blue bonnets. Chris loves the blue bonnets. So he really wanted to be here with this part of the year. He's got a real sensitive side, but he likes to tell the truth about alcoholism and about Alcoholics Anonymous, and he carries a very strong message. So you're in for a treat tonight. Come on, Chris.
God. My name's Chris Kramer, very grateful recovered alcoholic. I'm also a recovered drug addict. It's pretty cool being here and be able to talk about all that stuff. I've molested a few chickens too. I don't know, maybe, never mind. Got a lot of visitors in here that are fixing to get up and leave. There you go. Hi, thanks for an introduction. Hi. They said, Heidi's going to introduce you. And they said, Gray's going to introduce you. And Katie said, no, I'm going to introduce you. It's like, oh, shit, we're in trouble here. Something's up. I'm honored to be here. Patrick, I think, is the one that asked me to speak months ago. I book out a year in advance, and who knew that I was going to be here and Mark wasn't going to be here. He instilled in me when we first started working together this idea of living life one day at a time and not staying sober one day at a time for you little middle of the roaders. Living life one day at a time and getting excited about what you got in front of you, and that's so true. Even in death, he made that point abundantly clear to me. Anyway, I've loved this place. He was so excited about being a part of this deal, and it's great to come out here. And we came out early. We had our times a little skewed. We came out early. Patty drove me out, my personal chauffeur, and drove us out here. We pulled in just as the guys are, are praying before dinner. And it's like, God, it's so cool to see a place like this. This is the last time I'm going to talk about Mark Houston. It was the coolest to be in a room full of men and women heading in the same direction. I travel a lot, guys. Most of you guys have heard me speak before. Some of you have heard tapes I've done, CDs. And I work in this industry. I work for a hospital up in near Hunt, Texas. And that's where I met some of you guys here. Some of you guys, it's just a joke. I thought you were dead, here you are. My friend Jay takes a lick and keeps on picking some of the guys here. I got to see Joe M. is in here. He was the first guy that ever asked me to speak from the podium where they recorded it. This was 20 years ago, for God's sakes. And up in San Antonio. And as bad as I hate to speak from the podium, I guess I could just blame it on Joe. Mark loved to speak from podiums. I hate it. I love recovery. I love Alcoholics Anonymous. I love all 12-step stuff. And I believe that, as it was explained to me finally, I was years trying to get. I was 7 years in Alcoholics Anonymous trying to pick up a red chip. You'll follow. They talk about chronic relapse. People call me on the phone, Chris, you just don't understand. I've relapsed. And I'm laughing. They're like, buddy, you don't understand. I understand completely. Mr. Relapse, on my chest. I mean, I've done this 1,000 times, and I've got a bunch of years today. I've got 22 years it still takes my breath away when I think about it. But what changed in 1987 from 1980? What changed in those 7 years? I'm in the same damn rooms. There's the book's still there. The steps are on the wall. All the same stuff. But what's different was in 1987, I landed, after a suicide attempt. I'll talk to you a little bit about it. But I ended up in a room full of men and women that understood what the solution really was. And they were all carrying big books. And I say it, guys, because I might make them sound like they were mean. But I got to tell you, they loved me enough to finally tell me the truth. And I've said this from 1,000 podiums, but I thought tonight that I might start off with this. If you're working with a newcomer and you're trying to candy coat this message because you're afraid you're going to piss them off or scare them off, you need to quit that. You need to stop playing God with other people's lives. One of the cool things that Mark taught me when I first got sober was he said, I wish when people would share in meetings and talk from the podium and, just generally work with others, that if they shared some opinion, that they would say that it's an opinion. You follow? Because I sure had a lot of people for 7 years in Alcoholics Anonymous sharing nothing but opinions with me because there was nothing close to the big book. The idea out there in the real world is that sooner or later, sooner or later, if you want this bad enough or need it bad enough, that you can get this. You with us? So sooner or later, alcoholics and addicts that I've worked with over the years that just believe that it's like this cosmic time machine. You know, that sooner or later, I'm gonna get to a spot where I can get sober. And that's just not the way it is. Sooner or later, if you keep doing it the way you're doing it, you're gonna die. Sooner or later, if you don't open the big book and work some steps. Now see, everybody doesn't have to work the steps. That's what Mark explained to me. That's what some great sponsorship did. And that's where I'm coming from today, in a hospital where I work. I got to tell you folks, the belief that just showing up to a bunch of meetings will fix the problem needs to be smashed. And this is where I come from. This is why I catch the heat. It's because I'll say it from the podium. And because I sound angry sometimes with it, you know. And I'm so not. I'm passionate about hearing the solution. If a little guy sitting in here and he just wants to dig with this, and he doesn't particularly want to stay sober, he just wants the heat to go away, then what difference does it make? But I have to direct everything I say from the podium and in my meetings to the one little guy that may be there for the one and only time. Is he going to hear the solution, or is he going to hear a watered-down, candy-coated deal? Because guys, the way this disease works is that nobody can do it for us. If love was going to get me sober, I'd have been sober a gazillion years ago. I had plenty of love around me. But what I didn't have was the information on what to do. And everybody wants to pick bones with that. You with us? You didn't stay sober for those 7 years because you just didn't want to bad enough. You can share that story next week if you want to, from the same podium here if you want to. But my story is my story, and that's where I'm going to get into this thing. And I'm watching the clock closer than y'all, so just bear with me. But I'm going to share my story. And like I said again, it may differ from yours. Some of you guys in this room have come to us through treatment centers, and some of you guys just walked in the back door of a little AA meeting and got sober. Some of you came through our judicial system, you know, and it's like you were mandated, signing little sheets, and you stayed. Well, however way you got here, we're so glad to have you. You are absolutely welcome. And I'm just going to share my story. And if you can relate to it, great. If you can't, you know, that's fine too. I'm right and you're wrong. So let's just go. I was talking to Charlie. We're going to share the podium in Canada next month over to Katie and I, Charlie. And I was just over in Ontario a couple of weeks ago on a Thursday. And it's like a 2-hour, 3-hour car ride from the airport. You know, it's like, I was raised in this, I thought Texas was the only place that was big like that. But then, I mean, the shit, you could drive forever and not hit. Anyway, thank God they got Tim Hortons coffee there. So it was not that big deal. But God says, I've been so excited. We got a 3-hour car ride. And I've been so anxious because I just wanted to talk to you. I have some questions about some of the things that you talk about. Let me give you the translation of what that means. I don't agree with your crap. I've got you hostage for 3 hours. I call Patty on the phone. He's going to shoot me. You know, just... It's amazing to me how much stuff is out there disguised as recovery that's so not recovery. Make sense? Bill Wilson talks about this. Bill Wilson talks nonstop in the book. He says over and over he uses the term real alcoholic. You with us? Real drug addict in the other fellowships. You can. It's like because he's crystal clear about this. Because he knows that a lot of people are going to pretend to be alcoholic. You find that hard to believe. But he spends the first 60 pages trying to explain what it looks like to be an alcoholic or to be a drug addict. And we have so many people in meetings when I first got to AA, I'll tell you a little bit about it, but they were fanatic about it. If you think you're one of us, you are. Welcome. And I'm not going to say that because I got to find out if you are, because if you're not, I want you to go away. Please. nothing personal. But AA is not a social club. We're a spiritual fellowship of men and women trying to help other alcoholics and addicts get well. We're not here for your enjoyment. We have a job to do. And it's the hard drinkers, it's the little disco drunks that got scooped up by the net in the 80s, that got 25 years, that have never worked the 12 steps ever, sitting in meetings telling the newcomer, you're the most important person, you just keep coming back and everything's going to be okay. Wow. You keep coming back and don't work the steps, you will gradually go so crazy you can't stand it. The internal condition will absolutely reach up and grab you around the neck and you will be in trouble. And some of you are grinding your teeth right now. And I could give a rat's butt. Because I'm telling you point blank what we got to do. If you're not an alcoholic, you can't relate to another alcoholic. If you're not another drug addict, you can't relate to a drug addict. This whole drinking and drugging thing is a minor inconvenience for lots of people. For the real McCoy, it's fatal. Just don't drink and go to meetings. Oh, my God. I've been looking in this book a little bit. Mark Hedges kind of glanced through it occasionally. And I've been looking, and I can't find anywhere in here where it says in order to get sober, you've got to go to a bunch of meetings. 90 meetings in 90 days. Any of you guys ever hear that? I'm on a soapbox from hell about it, guys. We've got to somehow stop putting the emphasis on the number of meetings we go to and put the emphasis on the steps we work. Because it's the 12 steps that get us spiritually connected. The steps don't get us sober. The steps allow us to get spiritually connected. Listen, you can hear it now. He's knocking meetings. Knocking meetings. I go to meetings. But I don't stay sober because of those meetings. It's a part of a three-part program. The meetings are one part. But if you don't work the steps and then turn around and sponsor somebody, help somebody else get sober, you're not going to stay in this process. Make sense? The only people that stay sober, meeting maker make it, are the hard drinkers. Did y'all get that? Okay. Alcoholism and drug addiction, guys, is biological. It's not psychological. There are some psychological things that we can deal with, but there's nothing. If you're genetically wired like us, it will progressively get worse. And one day you will find that you can't stop. The craving kicks in, you're off the stupid races, and then you show your butt a few times and you say, God, I don't want to do this anymore. And then you try to put the plug back in the jug, and you try to lay the crack pipe down for good or whatever it is, stop shooting meth. And then what happens is you find you can't do that because your head tells you that it's okay to do that. That's what alcoholism and drug addiction looks like. Make sense? I've said it from a million podiums. If you can stop because you want to, on your own power, if you can stop because you need to, on your own power, you're not one of us. But I'm controversial saying that from the podium, and the knucklehead telling you to just keep coming back, go to lots of meetings, and everything's going to be okay, is okay. I grew up in Kerrville, Texas. I was actually born out in Odessa, out in the oil fields. My father was a printer, and he moved us to the hill country when I was about 11 years old, and graduated from Tybee High School. It's Tybee High School. It's Tybee High School. Tybee High School. And I'm lucky I graduated. I graduated in the very tip-top bottom of my high school class. And I got to tell you this, guys, if I hadn't discovered Boone's Farm, that my junior year, Boone's Farm apple wine, I wouldn't have graduated at all. You know, I was on a steady decline down. And I'll never forget those guys had a bottle about this big of Boone's Farm, and I was going to go out and split it with a friend of mine. We went out with leaned up against one of them big old 700-year-old cypress trees out there, west of Kerrville, between Kerrville and Ingram. We leaned up on there and polished off this little bottle. I took a couple of sips, and he took a couple of sips, and the story is just historic. He just said, God, that tastes like crap. And I said, boy, it's pretty sweet, isn't it? It's not quite what I imagined, you know, to be. And I don't know what I thought. You don't know what Boone's Farm is. What did I think? It's lime green with a screw cap. I mean, it's never seen a grape. What did I think it was going to taste like? I don't even know. He got up and laughed. He said, I don't want any more of that. And I said, Whoa, wait. Because I don't want you coming back later and saying you want some of this. You're telling me you're done. He said, yes, I'm done. And I said, bye-bye. Okay. Well, I'm going to sit here and swap mosquitoes for whatnot. It was cold. It was January. It was January 1971. I'll never forget it. Years later, I was to find out that was the month that Bill Wilson, the co-founder of Alcoholics Anonymous, had passed away. And Bill Wilson dies, and Chris Rager's born. You know, and I mean, that's how this thing works. And must have been some symbolic connection there someplace. But, oh my gosh! And I didn't get drunk. I hear people talking about thoughts. I got so drunk, and I puked straight up, and I didn't. I got to tell you, I drank that, and I'm sitting there. And I get up from that ground off that cypress tree, and I walk across two fields to my house, and I'm sitting there looking at that big old full moon, and I realize that high school's going to be okay, and life's going to be all right, and I'm okay. You know, for the first time in my life, a lot of them shake their heads in here. Like, I didn't get drunk. I just got right. You know what I'm saying? I chased that feeling forever. And early in my illness, I could hit that target with that feeling every time I drank. It's like, oh, shit. It was just the best. And I didn't get drunk every day. I didn't drink every day. But when I could, I got to that spot. And I was in the food business, and they let us drink behind the counter, and they didn't care as long as you showed up and did the food okay. You could drink. And they, I'm 18 years old behind the line at the end of the hill cooking with a beer down here. Talking about a stud, you know. And there was this little pantry girl. No, never mind. But I'd have never asked her out if it hadn't been for that beer underneath the counter. Y'all understand? That's exactly this stuff. Alcohol fixed what was wrong with me. And our family members don't understand that. Years later, they still think that that's the problem. That's why they want to jump on every freaking bandwagon to stamp out drugs. Let's do away with alcohol. You know, we tried that experiment. The alcohol's not the problem. The drugs is not the problem. Alcoholism's the problem. And only a small percentage of us are wired with that. If you happen to be blessed with that, my twin brother caught the bullet. We were talking earlier, my identical twin brother caught the bullet. I've got two sisters, a half-sister and a little sister. They never caught the bullet. They drank. You're with us? We were laughing the other day. My big sister, they have a big party in them. Every New Year's Day, and they have a big hot dog roast, and we were invited like that. And she said, "Chris, would you mom go into the store and get us some beer for this party?" And I said, "Absolutely not." And she handed me a $20. $20 bill. I said, "How many people are coming to this party?" And she said, "Well, I don't know, 60 or 70. I'm looking at them. Not 60 or 70 of my friends are coming to this party, I guarantee you. You better add some zeros to this dog, I guarantee it." And I went and bought a 12-pack of beer and came back, you know what I'm saying? And by the end of the party, there was still beer left in that 12-pack. There was one guy in there, polished off a couple of them, that was it. Y'all understand? I'm with losers to the bottom. I mean, just not cut from the same cloth. My twin brother and I, anyway, we ended up in Houston, and he's a bartender, and I'm a cook in the hotels over there. We're tearing Houston up, and I remember my 21st birthday in Houston, Texas. We're at the Mason Jar. Some of y'all from Houston, y'all know it. We're on 10, and we're sitting there drinking Mason jars and beer. We're just squashed. 21, we're ordering another beer. You know, and he said, "Man, we got to watch what we're doing. So we're going to end up just like cops." And I said, "Yeah. No, never. We'll get another beer over here, please." And we were off to the races. And oh my gosh, that was, I had a whole bunch of years left in me. And I'm holding it together pretty good. And I got married to try to fix the problem. And you know how that goes. Some of you have tried that same experiment. And I'm up in North Texas, and I've tried some other outside issues by then. Somebody showed me cocaine in 1979, and I'm adding that with the alcohol, and somebody down the road showed me some little some stuff called methamphetamine. Oh my God, I don't know what that was, but I cleaned a well when I was on that. And I was in the food business, and the chef should come in and says, "God damn, I never saw anybody work as hard as you." And you won't for about 4 days. And then I'm going to sleep. I'm going to go to bed for a while. But I'm really, really, really fighting some depression. And I'm seeing doctors in Houston. When I moved up to North Texas, I was seeing doctors. And the doctors were prescribing some medications for me to try to help me. And same stuff that a lot of y'all. The symptoms of untreated alcoholism look like a lot of other illnesses. Y'all follow? I mean, it freaks me out when somebody says, "Well, they diagnosed me with bipolar disorder. Had you done any methamphetamine that week?" "Well, yeah." "Then you've got you've got a wax diagnosis because the symptoms are going to look the same. Number one symptom of untreated alcoholism or drug addiction is depression. You with us? Are you depressed? I mean, they ask it when they first get into treatment. You know, the guys have come up and that's the one, some of the first questions. Are you depressed? Yes? I was trying to commit suicide in your parking lot, for God's sake. You're fixing to take away the only thing that ever made me okay inside, away from me. Like, yeah, I'm a little under the weather. Well, here, let's try this antidepressant. You know, and here we go. We're off to the races. I'm not knocking antidepressants. I'm just knocking antidepressants. So, I'm not. I'm just saying, you just got to be careful what you're doing with these medications. We're way over-prescribing people. And I've spent 10 years in therapy out there. And every time I'd see another therapist, they'd give me another diagnosis. And some of these diagnoses, again, they mirrored untreated alcoholism. So I'm taking I went to my first AA meeting. I was taking medication at the time. And by the time it was in 1980, and I've been married for about a year and a half, and to a first wife. And let me see, I got to count. My third wife's here. She'll keep me on track here. And I'm trying to save the marriage and trying to save a little business, and we have a little push and match, and I tell her I'll stop. And it was one of the first times. I've told people I was going to stop a gazillion times, but this was the time that I was going to draw a line in the sand and make it stick, and I really meant it. And that's what so many family members don't understand. They think we're just... And guys, I got to tell you, we as a fellowship, we'll play into this. You know, if an alcoholic's mouth's moving, they're lying. It's like a big joke. Except it's disrespectful, because it's not true. There's lots of times. Buddy, I was raised as a pretty honest old boy. There's lots of times I was telling you the truth. And when I told that wife and I told that employer that I wasn't going to drink and drug anymore, I meant it. I wouldn't go and smoke up anybody's butt. I was done. Guys, you drink and drug for a while and it's fun. And you drink and drug for a while and it's a pain in the ass, but it's still fun. You drink and drug long enough and it's just hell on earth. It's torture. And you don't want to do it, but you can't not do it. Because not doing it feels worse than doing it. You with us on that one? So when I told that lady and that boss and my friends that I was going to stop, I meant it. And 2 weeks later, I drank a beer with a chef after work and went home, patting myself on the back. And I walked in the door and she could smell it. She says, "God dang it!" I says, "I thought we had a deal." And the deal was in my head was that I wasn't going to come home drunk anymore. But the deal that I'd made with her was that I wasn't going to touch another drop. And she went to the bedroom and packed. And that was it for the marriage. And that was it for the third and fourth business. And I had 7 more years in me. 7 more years of excuses why my case is just a little bit different. I went to Alcoholics Anonymous that month to try to save the marriage and try to do what I could do to stay sober. But I got to tell you guys, I'm not speaking harshly towards any of those people in those meetings, but I spent a whole bunch of years sitting in meetings not hearing the solution. And I'm just... Bill Wilson, in some of his writings, there's a letter he did in 1942, in a letter, it said that our chief responsibility to the newcomer is an adequate presentation of the program. You follow? It's not to stand up on the podium and try to be hip slick and cool or sit in meetings and tell jokes and talk about your weed eater. It's to try to help the newcomer understand what this whole thing is about. And in 1980, when I went to my first meeting, we went around the room and everybody introduced themselves as recovering alcoholics, and then we talked about everything under the sun except recovery. And that's my story. 7 years sitting in those meetings listening to that stuff. And I wonder, in defense of some of the alcoholics and addicts in this room that have tried to stay sober before, could it possibly be that you just never heard the solution? That may sound harsh. You can go to meetings all over the world, folks, and not hear the solution out of the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous. If the fellowship would keep me sober, I would have been sober because I'm a meeting-making fool. 90 meetings in 90 days, I'll show you. 120 meetings in 90 days. But if all we're doing is talking about your problem or another war story, what good are we doing? Let me tell you what ties this room together. What ties this room together, most of us in here are alcoholics and addicts. Some of us are recovered, some of us are not. But what ties us together is not our drama. It is not our story. Page 17 says we have a common problem. That's one thing. It says it's one element. Because I got to have a problem. If any of these young men in here are going to relate to me, they need to know that it's coming from somebody that's walked in their shoes. You with us? But once they realize that we're walking in the same shoes, then what I need to do is shut up about it. and get on about my business of telling them what the solution is. Because in the next line it says, the one element of cement that binds us is the drama. But that could not hold us together as we're now joined. I'm sitting here talking to Jay with tears in my eyes tonight. Friends forever. Joe, I've known for 20 years. So many people in this room. We're not here because I was a drunk in Houston, Texas. We're here because we got sober. We've been out there in the trench kicking butt, taking names. Walking a spiritual path together. That's what ties us together. Y'all are on that same page? A bunch of you are not. Because you won't shut up about the stupid stories in the meetings. Those stories that we share are important from this podium on a Friday night. They're extremely important, absolutely necessary in a 12-step call. You with us? I'm going to go to the old hotel over here, Motel 6, and got us a little crackhead in there, a little dope fiend. You with us? And I got to go talk to him. I better have a story or he ain't even going to let me in the room. You with us? I'm going to talk to him a little bit about my story. We're going to get together. Then I'm going to take him to a meeting. Once I've got him in the meeting, we're done with the stories. Shut up about it. And you've got to keep it green. If you ever forget your story, you'll drink again. But that's not what the book says. The book is crystal clear. It says you won't forget, remember your story. On page 24, it says you won't remember the consequences of a week or a month ago. Your fear won't keep you sober, will it? How many of you guys ever drank and drugged on probation? Whoa! Let the record show all the hands are up. Well, didn't you remember you were on probation? Not for a second. Maybe vaguely I remembered and we're off to the stupid races. Y'all follow? That's the insanity that is alcoholism. So what we need to talk about is the solution. Get these guys coming from the hospitals. Guys, a lot of you guys have been to the hospital where I work. They're sitting down there at SEU, you know, this little care. They're getting some detox meds, you know, and then they look up on the wall. They start to clear the Ativan haze, you know, and they go, oh my God. They look on the walls and see the 12 steps and they go, shit. Yeah, they're not. Just more AA? Oh my God, I've done this. It doesn't work. And you just want to hug them because they were just like me for all those years. Y'all understand that? You did AA because you're saying you did it because you went to a bunch of stupid meetings. That's not AA. That's a piece of it. Did you sit down and open the title page of the book where it says that you can recover and work all the 12 steps in a quick manner, fast manner, get through them from point A to point B so that you can have the necessary spiritual experience? Well, I worked the steps to the best of my ability. That means you didn't work the steps. That's what that means. Ain't it right? God bless their hearts. Because I'm there to tell them it does work. Because I finally did it in 1987. Had they offered me another choice, I wouldn't have. Y'all realize how confusing this is to the newcomer? Newcomer comes in and says, you know, picks up a chip, and I'm the most important person here, yeah, and everybody's loving and hugging. He thinks it's going to be okay. And about the time he starts to get comfortable in his skin, you with us? There's an old guy over here, he's got a big book all banged. Y'all know the kind I'm talking about, right? He's got duct tape all around it. He's been just falling apart, you know? And he's over there, and he's making eye contact with this guy, and he says, let me see you after the meeting. We'll visit. You with us? The little guy says, okay. And you got somebody sitting back over here by the coffee machine, and they're going, no, no, come here. So you go back over there like that, and it's this nice lady. She says, listen, you've got to ignore this guy up here. He's a big book fanatic. He's just a knucklehead. You don't need to worry about that right now. All you need to do is just go to lots of meetings, and everything's going to be okay. You follow? Come on, guys. I know dozens of you that have been there. I've been there. Is this guy trying to hurt me? Absolutely not. He's trying to show me the path. Is the lady trying to hurt me? Absolutely not. She's trying to make it as easy for me as possible. Except I have a progressive illness that's kicking my ass. Unless I get the real message, get connected to the real power, I'm not going to stay sober. Y'all understand this? The best you can do in a meeting is tell a newcomer to keep coming back. Quit. Just don't say anything. Because you're not helping. God, you're confusing the bejesus out of them. 7 years in and out of Alcoholics Anonymous, and I'll stay sober for a short period of time, and I'll come back in and pick up another chip, and the old guy in the front will just kick the other guy and say, Beth, see, I told you, he just didn't want it bad enough. Wow. Wow. I'm taking 7 pills a day in 1987, and I'm dying, and I'm coming apart. And I picked up a stack of return checks up in North Texas and pulled into my little apartment. I live in a little efficiency apartment in Louisville, Texas. My sister-in-law co-signed for me. I'm 35 years old. Thank God for family, you know. Because if it hadn't been for family, I'd been on the street. Y'all understand that? I'm driving a little $600 pickup. Y'all think the little pickup, the truck I drive now looks like hell. You should have seen this $600 pickup. And, oh my, leaned on one side, one of the windows was out. And, you know, the mosquitoes were in there in the summer, and the ice was in there in the winter. It was a big old whiskey den with a license plate was all it was. And there was no furniture in that apartment. I'd lent my furniture to a friend. He promised he would hold that furniture for me. Oh my gosh, along with every piece of electronic equipment I ever had. I don't know. He was terrible. What do you think, I have a pawn shop? Anyway, I'm sitting on the floor, and a couple little stinky ferrets in there, and I got a little ivy that's dying over there in the corner, and I'll never forget it. It's cold in that little apartment, and I'm looking at those return checks and realized I'd killed another banking account, and I'm going to have to go to my sister-in-law tomorrow and borrow some money to cover. Y'all follow? Guys, we're not talking high finance here. You know, we're talking, you know, $60 will evacuate a checking account at that point in my life, and now I'm going to have to go back and cover that, and I mean, oh my God. And I just said, I can't do it. And I got up and I took a couple bottles of pills and tried to commit suicide. I tried to die. No letter, no nothing. I'm so done with this. Guys, I have a great family, and I've got a twin brother I'm closer to than anybody on earth. And I'm so done with hurting everybody in my life. About the time those pills hit my stomach, I'm feeling a little nauseated, I'm sitting down on the side of the bed, and I hear this voice that says, "Don't do this, go back to AA." It's one of these voices, guys. It's not a little thought in my head. Perhaps I should give AA another chance. This was a voice that said, "Don't do this, go back to AA." And I freaking me out. I heard it two times that night, three times as I lay down. I made myself sick the last time I heard it. And I conked out, and I woke up the next morning, and before I got out of bed, I heard this voice that said, "Don't do this, go back to AA." Same voice. And I said, shit. And hair standing up on the back of my neck. And I made a promise I would go back to Alcoholics Anonymous. And 6 o'clock that night, I'm in a meeting I'd never been to before. I'm sitting out in the back, parked behind this AA meeting. I didn't want anybody to know I was going back to AA. You with me? Shit. Years later, I found out I was on the prayer list of every church in Kerrville, Texas. You know? Thanks, Mom. But I'm going to tell you, you know, here I am. I'm down and ashamed of it. I'm going to go back to Alcoholics Anonymous. And I'm talking myself out of it. Y'all know how that works. You have such a head of steam, you know, at 8 o'clock this morning. And then, you know, 6 o'clock tonight, it's like, ah, shit. You know, I'm going to go home and finish this detox thing a little bit. And then maybe Monday I'll go to this A&A meeting. You know, and here I go. I believe I had my first part of my spiritual experience that night, and I found my little skinny butt sliding across that truck seat and getting out. And I walked in the back door of that meeting, and it was back in the day we could smoke, and everybody was smoking, and, you know, cloud coming down. Y'all heard me 1,000 times. I walked in there and got about halfway in, and I'm just hyper-vigilant, you know. I'm a big old guy at the time. I've got a bunch of weight on me, and I got a big full beard. And that was the joke when I got sober. It says, was it an eye patch or an earmuff? You know, it was always crooked. I always had food in my beard, you know, because I was just a mess, you know. And I think I'm looking rather rugged, a man's man, you know. A man's man who subscribes to Cosmopolitan. Oh my God, I mean, this was a confusing life I was leading, I gotta tell you. And I got about halfway in, and everybody's laughing, and there's a guy over there I know, and a lady over there I know, and I've been in North Texas going to meetings for years, guys. So they know me. They know who I am. Hey, welcome back, and come on in. And I'm feeling very, very self-conscious, and I got about halfway in, and I says, shit, I just can't do this. And I took a step back, and this little girl that snuck up on my right-hand side, she swears it was an accident. She got on my blind side. She came right up behind me. She's 19 years old, 18, 19 years old. And she snuck up behind me like that, hooked her finger in my belt loop. She didn't say, "Would you care to join?" She hooked her finger in my belt loop and set me down in a chair. She said, "Sit down, cowboy. You're not going anywhere." Because her sponsor had said, "Get him." And she got me. It's true, absolute truth. Today we, you know, we're so socially correct. Men work with men and women work with women, and don't go nin and nin and nin and nin and nin and nin and nin. I'm going to go to a young adult meeting and talk about young adult issues. And if this little girl had been in another middle meeting, you would have been, I'd have been dead. And that's just my story. And that's why I don't go to meetings where other, the opposite sex is not there. We get a chance to learn a whole lot of cool stuff. And I know some of you, I don't want to hear it afterwards. I know you go to the perfect women's meeting and you just changed your life. Rock on, how cool is that? But I'm just saying, I would have died if that had happened to me. Y'all understand? Because back in the day, she sat me down, the chairperson saw me and waved at me like that. She says, buddy, we got a guy back in. He's coming back in again. Welcome back, Chris. You with us? I was a little embarrassed. He called me out in the meeting. Thank you. You're with us? And then they went around and he said, ordinarily we do this meeting this way, but let's do it this way. He said, let's share how our lives have changed as a result of working the steps. You know, the simple fact that a chairperson would absolutely take charge of a meeting takes my breath away. You know, we've got the same old crappy format we've been using for 30 years that nobody particularly likes, but nobody's going to change it for nothing. You with us? Well, this is your meeting. Let's talk about whatever you want to. Hey, we got a guy that's dying in our midst. Why don't we help him? What a concept. I got to tell you, I set up. And they started doing it. And they went around the room. There was about 30 people in that. I don't know. There was a bunch of people in that room. It was a small, narrow room. And they all went around and they started talking about how their lives had changed as a result of working the steps. You know what that means? It means if you weren't working the steps, you passed. Because you didn't have anything to say. It just makes me want to spit when I go to meetings like this. We're talking about four-step and the first person. Well, I want to share. Well, I've never done a four-step. But listen, this is what, you know, I know. Don't talk about an experience you've never had. Mark Houston was huge about this nonsense. If you've had an experience and you can share it with somebody, by all means do that. We want to hear it. But if you've never done it, shut up! Shut up! Because you've got no point of reference. They went around the room and the people that had worked the steps and whose lives had changed as a result of working the steps, man, I'm going to tell you something, folks. They talked about stuff that I could relate to. You want to talk about God meeting you where you're at? They talked about getting their credit cards back. And they talked about having cool jobs and getting in cool relationships and buying houses and going back to school. All the stuff that I thought, guys, I'm less than 24 hours away from a suicide attempt. And now they're talking about stuff that I could do in sobriety. I'm 35 and I think my life's over. And they're there to tell me exactly how not my life is over. Wow. Not one person told me how they got here. I didn't have to hear about one effing DWI. I didn't have to hear about anybody going to jail because that wasn't the instructions that the chairperson gave them. Y'all understand that? They didn't waste any time rehashing their tired old boring war story. They shared the one thing that I needed more than anything on the face of the earth that night. They shared hope with me. Shit. At the end of the meeting, the guy said, buddy, you want to get some of this? You want to do this? I said, absolutely. And I got a chip. And at the end of the meeting, he came up, he sat in the little chair next to me, had one of them old busted up big books we were talking about. And he said, Chris, he said, I got to ask you this question. He said, do you really want to do this? Because my book asked me to ask you if you're done. Not one day at a time. Are you done? You don't have the power to just do this. But one day at a time. But we're going to show you how to live life one day at a time. We're going to show you how to do this. And I said, yeah, I need somebody to show me. And he hugged me. And they got me to my car and somebody followed me home. Make sure I got there. I'm detoxing. And the next morning they were at my doorstep. 9 o'clock. They're going to haul me back to a meeting. I tried to talk my way out of this. You know, oh my God. I'm running around the apartment looking for a patch. Who the hell's at my door at 9 o'clock in the morning? And it's the A&A guys, and they hauled me back, and we went to a cool meeting in the morning, and then we went to the back room, and they asked me about God, and we did a third step prayer, and then we went to lunch, and they came back, and they gave me a notebook, and we started working on a four step. Boom, 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 boom. I'd been in AA for 7 years. I get more people come up after that. That's way too fast. If they've asked me to do, you know, buddy, everybody does them a little bit different, but the urgency that we do the steps is the biggest mistake we make in our fellowships today. Because we got this idea, especially from folks coming from treatment, that we've got plenty of time to do this. We've got people in this room right now, I guarantee you, telling their little sponsees, you didn't get this sick overnight, you're not going to get well overnight. Well, you're being kind of risky with that. Because that's not what the book says. The book says we beg of you to be fearless and thorough from the very start. We beg of you to seek the solution with the desperation of a drowning man. And listen, folks, taking 9 months to do a four-step doesn't sound very desperate to me. you somehow think that you can stay sober. Guys, remember the last time that obsession came back and your head went out and said, yes, you can do this. You'll follow? I got to get well. See, a recovered alcoholic, that obsession goes away. Man, I'm loving those guys. Didn't want to do any of that work. I fought it tooth and nail, but I did it. 2 weeks later, I'm sitting on the tailgate of my truck and it dawns on me that the obsession to use has gone away. And I've recovered and I'm surrounded by liquor stores and my dope dealer lives there sitting on my goddamn couch and I'm done. And I'm done. I'm sitting there and the obsession's gone and it hadn't returned in 22 years. Guys, listen. And I ended up getting married a few years later and I moved back here to the Hill Country and I started working at this hospital there in Hunt, Texas, and that's where I met Mark, and we started doing the work together, and he was one of the guys that finally told me, he said, Chris, you know what the message is, because you've had some good sponsorship up to this point. The problem is that you're afraid to share it because you're afraid of what other people are going to think about it. And I agreed with him. And I this idea out there in recovery land is that we are... I had a guy say it tonight. He said, well, I wish I could be like you, Chris. I wish I just didn't give a shit what people thought. You know, and it makes me want to cry because I care so much what you think as a friend and a brother and a sister in this fellowship. I am not that thick, calloused person. Mark said, I care. I just can't care so much that it changes the message. And that's the cool piece that I want to leave you guys with here in just a second. It takes every single one of us in this room to carry this message. There's some little hard eggs like me out here telling how they can, and I can crack a few that can't crack any other way. And there's some very gentle people in here that can do the same thing, same message. Bill's story up in the front of the book, it says, each in our own way carry this message. Charlie will carry the message different than me, and my wife Patty, bless her, she just cuts straight to the chase. You know, you'll get up and have been gutted and not even know it. She just is, but it's just very direct and to the point, very direct, because we understand. Guys, I can't keep you sober. Talking to a lady on the phone yesterday, a mother, this 70-year-old mother, son is drunk again, back in his fourth treatment center, and she's crying on the other end. They've spent all their money trying to get this guy sober and listen to this woman cry. You know, and I'm sitting there thinking, yeah, I'm going to go blow smoke up this kid's ass. I'm going to go lie to him and candy coat this message. Bill Wilson, in 1935, they got together and they started writing this book. In 1939, it was published. It's the clear, precise solution to alcoholism and drug addiction. You do this work, you get well. Never seen anybody not do it. You don't have to do it exactly perfect, I don't think. I certainly don't. The people that are not getting sober in this room, folks, are not people that are working the steps incorrectly. They're the people that are not working the steps at all. And unfortunately, too many people in this room are surrounded by people who are encouraging them to go slow. It takes the breath away when we have this idea that there's plenty of time to do this work. When the obsession goes away, guys, I can't tell you when it's going to come back. I can stay sober on the drop of a dime without God I've proved it for weeks. I've done it once, 3 months at a time. And then when the little boys come back and say, you can smoke a joint, I'm off. I'm off. And I may argue with that voice a little bit. No, I don't think so. Well, how about a beer? No, I don't. You know, if you can argue for a while. Then inevitably the little boy says, what are you, a pussy? No, it's a fuck. And I'm going to go drink. And I'm going to go drink. And that's just what we do. We were talking earlier about some of the cats that are on the fellowship. I've got some buds from the hospital that works here, and we were talking about it 17 years ago when I started working in a hospital. Every once in a while, we'd get an old guy through the hospital. Somebody that had some long-term sobriety, and they lost it. We'd all, you know, wow, what happened? You know, we'd get in around them and find it out. And I got to tell you something, guys. Fast forward 17 years today at that hospital, there is a full, some of y'all from that hospital, y'all know what I'm talking about. There's probably a full quarter of our community there, the 100 patients there, full quarter of them had multiple years of sobriety, 5 years or more, and lost it. I cannot tell you how many alcoholics and addicts that had long-term sobriety that we're losing around a stupid prescription pad. Non-stop around the prescription pads. Doctor, you can take this Ambien. You just need some sleep. Oh, but I'm a drug addict. Oh, it doesn't matter. This is non-addictive. Rock on. You know, for some people, it doesn't seem to be. And I can name you 100 right now that have relapsed around the crap. It's called lack of transparency. I'm not a doctor. I'm not telling you what to do. I'm saying pay attention to what you put in your system. Y'all follow where we're at? Here's where I'm going with this. With all these guys coming back in, I'm asking them the question. Guys, there's a guy up there right now that had 20 years and lost it. And I ask him the simple question. I slide up next to him because I do it with every one of these old geezers because they're my mentors. These are the cats that I... And I slide up next to him and I ask him. I don't ask him what happened because that doesn't make any difference. You didn't drink because of something external. You drank because of something that was going on inside. The internal condition, the spiritual malady that the book talks about. I ask him one question. Buddy, let me ask you a question. At 20 years sober, how many men were you sponsoring? None. Well, what the hell did you think was going to happen? Because our fellowship believes it's an option to work with others. And it's not. Bill Wilson, on the top of page 14 and 15, he's being 12 steps. He's in Towns Hospital doing work with his friend Eddie. Eddie tells him, and this is Bill talking, he said, "My friend had emphasized the absolute necessity of demonstrating these principles in all my affairs. Particularly was it imperative to work with others as he'd worked with me. Faith without work was dead," he said, "and how appallingly true for the alcoholic or dope fiends." So, paraphrase. "For if the alcoholic fails to perfect and enlarge his spiritual life through work and self-sacrifice for others, he could not survive the certain trials and low spots ahead." Do y'all get it? Didn't say he might not. He said he will not. And that's been my experience. We've got this belief in AA today and around our other sister fellowships of Cocaine Anonymous, Crystal Meth Anonymous, that some of us can sponsor and some of us don't have to sponsor. I'm sorry. That's not what my big book says. My big book says that you're supposed to get in the trench with me and help me in your own way to carry the message. I was talking to somebody the other day, Katie, and they said, "How many people do you sponsor?" I said, "God, I don't know. I probably sponsor about 30 guys." He says, "Oh my God, if you sponsor more than 3 men, your ego's in charge. That's way too many." I said, "Shit, I'll say the same thing I always say. If you'd sponsor a few more, I could sponsor a few less." And I got to wind this down. I'm preaching to the choir because I know a bunch of you guys. I sponsor a bunch of you guys in here. And I know what you do. This is the beauty of this whole thing, is that each of us in our own way get a chance to be a part of this. I've told this story 1,000 times, folks. I've sat in meetings at the beginning of the meeting and done a serenity prayer and got quiet and closed my eyes and... I don't know, something happened in 15 minutes, 20 minutes into the meeting. My head wanted to drink so bad I could taste it. Just like that, sitting in a meeting, the spiritual malady comes back, and I want to go do some dope. You follow? My head's screaming at me, arguing. Usually around a big piece of self-pity. You follow? See, I don't want to go there again. I don't want to ever go back to that again. That daily battle of, am I going to use, am I not going to use? I love my life today. I love the friends I've got. I love my health. I love those blue bonnets. They're just... I got to tell you real quick. Some of y'all, I don't know where he got that stuff, but I got to tell you. I got a... We were laughing the other day about this again. I've talked about this from a gazillion podiums, but I think it's a worthy analogy. I was a cyclist for a long time, rode bikes forever, and I've been riding, I guess, 5 years and still never run 100 miles. And, you know, and if you're a cyclist, especially if you're riding a road bike, eventually, I'm not talking about my motorcycles. I don't have the cojones to ride motorcycles, but I can do a bicycle, and I'm riding it. I have never done a 100-mile ride, and everybody does a 100-mile. Eventually, that's what you do. It's just a goal you work towards. It really doesn't take that much if you just practice a little bit. A couple of weeks, you can ride 100 miles, but I've never done it. And we set out one Saturday to do it, and we all met up at the sports center. A lot of y'all been to Kerrville, and y'all know what the sports center is, right there at Harper Road. And we're going to ride out. There's about 20, 25 of us, a bunch of people who joined us, and we're going to do this. This is how it was touted. We're going to do a nice, leisurely 100-mile ride. Because the guys I train with, they're all hammerheads, and there's nothing nice or leisurely about the way they ride. They're just 100 miles an hour. So, but I'm going with a bunch of old busted-down geezers like me, and it's just... Okay, so we're ready to go. We know it's going to get cold. We've all got our cold weather gear on. We're loaded with food, so we're going to head out. We take off across the hills, and we get out about 25 miles, and this little cold front was supposed to hit. This wasn't a little cold front. This was West Texas, Kyle, you know, dry line. We all put our cold stuff on, and we got charged up and nutrition, food, and you know, with us, and we're headed out again. Guys, listen, this has gotten nasty. We're going straight into the wind, and it's cold like a son of a gun. We get out about 75 miles, and we stop at this little gas station, and most of the people have left. And we're still about 15 people there, and we stop at this gas station. They're all looking for a phone. This is before the day of cell phones. This back, none of us had one. It wouldn't matter if I had one anyway, because there was nobody to call. You know what I'm saying? And we sat there like that. It was about six of us. We said, let's just finish this ride, damn it. It's 25 more miles. We'll finish it, and we'll be done with this. And it wasn't fun anymore. You'll follow. It's getting dark outside. It's sleeting with us. It's just stupid. We should not have been out there. It's getting dark. Everybody else said, you know, guys, have a nice life. Bye-bye now. And they took off, and we got back on our bikes and headed out. And guys, I got to tell you, as I'm getting on that bike, I'm thinking, this is so stupid. I'm exhausted. I'm 75 miles out, and this is, everybody else is, the strong riders too. But everybody did what they were supposed to do. And we made a deal that the strong riders, some of the guys that we rode with were professionals, and they got in the front. Usually in a Peloton, you know, everybody takes turn at the front, at leading, and you get to rest in the back. And we didn't do that this time because we were done. And there was more than once in this little 25-mile stretch, I felt a hand on my butt pushing me up a hill, you know, and it's like, that's what they did. The strong people got around us, weak guys, and pushed us on up the hill. There was one guy, all he did was sit in the back because he had the light, and a little flashing light, because the cars couldn't see us. It was getting dark, and the sleet, the windows were all messed up. The guys, and we were, there was not one of us in the six of us that didn't hit the asphalt on that eye. Every time we'd hit a cattle guard, all of us would go down. You know, it's like, the ones in their head were leading us, trying to protect the ones in the back. And I got to tell you guys, I'll never forget, we pulled back down into that sports center and pulled into that parking lot, and I looked down at my little odometer and it clicked over 100. You with us? And everybody in the place, we looked at each other like that. There wasn't a word said. Hey, where did it? It was not a silence. We got off the bikes and we put them on our cars. We went inside and we took a shower. We got in our sauna and we're just sitting there. And what we did was just look around at each other and we just, you know, like, still to this day, I work with one of the girls that was on that ride. We've never talked about the ride. All we do is look at each other and go, huh? Huh? Remember that? Yeah? Everybody says, what? What? Nothing. Nothing. You wouldn't understand. A bunch of you in here will never understand. Because you ain't on that bike ride. You're not in the trench. You're sitting on the sideline doing just exactly the minimum you need to stay sober one stupid day at a time. And you're missing the whole show. Bill Wilson, Dr. Bob talks about the most thrilling years of your life lie ahead in this journey. Not the journey of just staying sober so that you can be Mr. Happy-Go-Lucky. So that you can stay sober and turn around and help somebody else up. To do the work with somebody else. And I got to tell you something, folks. That's one of the things that Mark Houston instilled in me. And that's what this entire facility was based around. One little busted up drunk helping and one other little busted up drunk. And the together you go, you get you a third one and a fourth one and a fifth one. Why will we survive? Why didn't the dumpsters of Houston, Texas swallow me up? How did I survive those overdoses? I don't know. Not because I'm good. But there was an old man that explained it 6 months after I got sober, and he leaned across a kitchen with a towel in his hand, wife washing an old ashtray, and he looked up with tears in his eyes, and he said, buddy, I got to tell you, we need you. We need you in Alcoholics Anonymous. And it's the first time in 7 years that anybody had ever said that to me. They'd said, keep coming back, but they'd never said, we need you. And I got to say it, I'm going to end with it. I know so many of y'all in this room that are lifelong friends of mine. That have been sober a long time. And you've been in that same trench with me. You've been on that 100-mile ride. we know what it's like to go and speak from podiums and go to detox centers and halfway houses and carry the message and haul people, be of service to our fellows. I'm going to tell you something, guys. We are the only game in town. There is not a treatment center out there. There's no medication coming down the pipe that's going to fix this problem. It happens unapologetically about God. It's about the spiritual experience. And that message is not being carried very well in our fellowships, in any of our fellowships. We walk on eggshells around it. Nobody wants to talk about God. You don't want to scare the newcomer off. Well, goddamn, I thought this is how we stayed sober. It is. Y'all follow how confused the newcomer gets? Guys, my spiritual experience is going to be different than your spiritual experience. You with me? I had one 22 years ago that changed my life at a cellular level. The obsession went away. Cindy's spiritual experience she's having this week working at this facility is going to be different than mine. It's going to be sufficient enough to keep us on the spiritual path. Sufficient enough is to keep us with enough power to never have to worry about relapse again. We need everybody in this room carrying that same message, folks. We need it from the podiums. We need a few less comedians from the podiums. We need a few less... Oh, Jesus. We need some people that feel strongly about the power of God sitting in these meetings, helping the newcomers. That's what we need. All of you little new guys, we need every single one of you. The little new guy's not going to hear it from an old geezer like me sometimes. No, they need to hear it from somebody else. The women in here, they're not going to hear it from me. They need somebody to gently maybe carry the same message with as much force, but in a kinder, gentler way. We need every woman in this place, in the trench with us, carrying the message. We were just talking to Charlie and Katie earlier before the meeting. We got people all over the world calling right now, today. There's not a day I don't get an email from somebody wanting women. Gosh, don't we have any women out there speaking from the podium, talking about the power of God? We do. Very few. And the ones that are getting stretched too thin. They're just beat. We need people to step up to the podium, folks. We need people to help carry this message. You got piercings, you got tattoos, come with us. Come with us. We need you. You're with us? You're black, gay, straight. I don't care. In the trench, carrying the message. Does that make sense, guys? Because it's a journey you'll never miss. You think you can't help anybody. I've heard it in therapy for years. You're too sick to help anybody. You've got to get well first. You see, guys, we get well by helping others. That's how we do it. You got 30 days, you got 40 days, you got just talked to little brother, they got 60 days. How cool is that? 60 days with no alcohol and no dope? Oh my God. How many people in Austin, Texas do you think are coming in today with no sobriety? You can help them. I love every one of you. Thanks so much for letting me come out here and do this.
Pastor, I'm an addict. Let's thank Chris Hammer once more for our and I've asked Grant Street that man set promises for us tonight.
My name is Branch and I'm a drug addict. We are painstaking about the phase of our development. We will be amazed before we are halfway through. We are going to know a new freedom and a new happiness. We will not regret the past nor wish to shut the door on it. We will comprehend the word serenity and we will know peace. No matter how far down the scale we have gone, we will see how our experience can benefit others. That feeling of usefulness and uselessness and self-pity will disappear. We will lose interest in selfish things and gain interest in our fellows. Self-seeking will slip away. Our whole attitude and outlook upon life will change. Fear of people and of economic insecurity will leave us. We will intuitively know how to handle situations which used to baffle us. We will suddenly realize that God is doing what for us what we could not do for ourselves. Are these extravagant promises? We think not. They are being fulfilled among us sometimes quickly, sometimes slowly. They will always materialize if we work for them.
Now just stand on our chairs for the Lord's Prayer, please.
Thank you, Patrick.
Can I take this out, Mr. Driver?
He keeps the shovel.